antenna. So here, in case of crustaceans, you have two pairs of antenna. And with respect to eyes, we have a stalked compound eyes. So if you look in the diagram, this is the compound eye. So the compound eye is situated on the stalk. So you can make out here, this is the stalk. On the stalk, you have the compound eye. So in case of crustaceans, example is crab, you have a stalked compound eyes. And with respect to number of legs, you have five pairs of legs. If you look in the diagram, first pair, second pair, third pair, fourth pair, fifth pair. So totally, you have five pairs of legs that are used for walking purpose. And when you come to the position of genital opening, if you come to the position of genital opening, it is situated somewhere in the anterior part of the body. So the genital opening is situated in the anterior end of the body. So the examples, you can take crab, prawn, lobster, etc. And coming to the mouth parts. So morning I was telling you, based on the mouth parts, we can classify the arthropoda into chelicerata and mandibulata. So here, in crustaceans, you have mandibles one pair, maxilla two pairs. So when you come to mouth parts, you have two pairs of maxilla and one pair of mandibles. And coming to the mode of respiration, so the crabs usually, they either respire through gills or the body surface. So body surface means the outer skin. So crustaceans can live both on land as well as on water. So once they are in water, they respire through gills. Once they are on land surface, they respire through body surface. And here, when you come to the type of development, so they develop with the larval stages. So they develop with larval stages. So you come to the habitat of these crustaceans, they may either live in salt water or fresh water, or sometimes they may also live on the land surface. So this is all about the characteristic features of subphylum Crustacea, especially crabs, prawns and lobsters. So body is divided into cephalothorax and abdomen, two pairs of antenna, stalked compound eyes, five pairs of legs, genital opening anterior, and mouth parts, one pair of mandible, two pair of maxilla, respiration by gills or body surface, development by larval stages. They may be salt water, fresh water, or land surface. So these are the characteristic features of subphylum Crustacea. The next one is class Arachnida. Okay, the slides are visible. So in class Arachnida, the body is also divided into cephalothorax and abdomen. So if you look here, this region is the cephalothorax. This region is the cephalothorax and this region is the abdomen. And here, if you look in the head region, in head region, the antenna is absent. So in case of Arachnida, that is spiders, scorpions and mites, the antenna is absent. And here you don't find any compound eyes, you find only simple eyes. So you'll find only simple eyes. So here if you look, you may have some small dotted structure. So these are called as simple eyes. So simple eyes, they cannot form the image. And here in case of arachnids, you have four pairs of legs. So if you look in the diagram, so this is the first pair of leg, second pair of leg, third pair of leg, fourth pair of leg. So 1, 2, 3, 4. So arachnids have four pairs of legs. So here also, like crustaceans, the genital opening is anterior in position. So genital opening will be somewhere in anterior position. So the examples I can take spiders, scorpions, mites and ticks. So with respect to mouth parts, so morning I was telling you based on the mouth parts, we can classify them into chelicerata and mandibulata. So these arachnida come under chelicerata, where you have one pair of chelicera and one pair of pedipalp. So if you look in the diagram, these are the chelicera. So left side chelicera, right side chelicera. Similarly, left side pedipalp, right side pedipalp. So here mouth parts consists of one pair of chelicera and one pair of pedipalps. So these arachnids, they respire either through book lungs or trachea. So respiration is through book lungs or trachea. And you come to the developmental stages. When you come to the developmental stages, so here mites and ticks, they have larval stages. So in mites and ticks, you come across larval stages, whereas in others, it is direct development. So coming to the habitat, some of the arachnids are terrestrial nature and few of them are aquatic in nature. So I have terrestrial forms as well as aquatic forms. So the next relative of class phylum Arthropoda, that is this class Chylopoda. So next one is class Chylopoda. The examples are centipedes. So as you look in the diagram, these are the centipedes. So in earlier two classes, that is crustaceans and arachnids, the body was divided into cephalothorax and abdomen. But in case of Chylopoda, the body is divided into head and trunk. For example, this is the head region, this is the trunk region. So look here, this is the head and this is the trunk. And here you'll find one pair of antenna. If you look here you'll find one pair of antenna. And here also, like arachnids, you'll find simple eyes. So in the head region, you'll have simple eyes. The next important character is with respect to legs. So if you take previous classes, in crustaceans, we have 5 pair of legs. In arachnids, we have 4 pair of legs. But here, you have one pair of leg per segment. So as you see in the diagram, you have one pair of leg per segment. And next, the genital openings here it is posterior. So as you look in the diagram, the genital opening will be posterior, whereas in previous cases the genital opening was in the anterior position. So the examples, as you see here, it is centipedes. So here they belong to subphylum Mandibulata. So you have mandibles one pair and maxilla two pairs. And they respire through trachea. So these respire through trachea. And here you don't find any larval stages. It is direct development. It is direct development. And all centipedes, they are terrestrial in nature. That is, they live on land surface. They are terrestrial in nature. So these are the characteristic features of class Chylopoda. The next one is class Diplopoda. The next one is class Diplopoda. So here also the body is divided into head region and trunk region. So if you look here, this is the head region and this is the trunk region. And as you see in the diagram, you find one pair of antenna. So here you'll find one pair of antenna. So here also you'll come across simple eyes. So if you take a close up of this head, you'll find two dot like structures here. So these are simple eyes. But important characteristics is with respect to legs. So if you look here, each segment has two pairs of legs. So as we look in the diagram, each segment, it has two pairs of legs. So here, remember, diplo means two, poda means legs. That means you have two pairs of legs in each segment. So diplo means two, poda means legs. So you have two pairs of legs in each segment. And coming to other one, so here the genital opening is anterior in position. So genital opening will be somewhere anterior in position. So example, I told you millipedes. So mouth parts, one pair of mandibles and one pair of maxilla. So in the head region, you may come across one pair of mandibles and one pair of maxilla. So here the respiration is through trachea. The respiration is through trachea. And here also you don't find any intermediate stages. The development is direct. The development is direct. And the principal habitat is terrestrial. So I think most of you, when you were kids, you might have experienced this. So whenever you touch a millipede, it gets coiled like this. So what may be the reason? Why does it get coiled? So since it may be thinking that you will harm it, so it will make itself into a spiral shaped structure. The next one is class insecta, which we are very much interested for this course. So here the body is divided into three regions. The anterior most region is the head region. The middle most region is the thorax, and the posterior most region is the abdomen. So here body is divided into head, thorax and abdomen. So here in all the insects, you will find one pair of antenna. So in all the insects, you will find one pair of antenna. And you come to the eyes, you come across both simple eyes as well as compound eyes. So in case of insects, you find both simple eyes as well as compound eyes. And in the thoracic region, you will find three pairs of legs. So this is the first pair of legs or prolex. This is the second pair of legs or mesothoracic legs. And this is the third pair of legs or metathoracic legs. So we have prolex, mesothoracic legs and metathoracic legs. And the next one is genital opening. So genital opening is posterior. So somewhere here in the posterior region, you'll find genital organs. And examples, as you know, grasshoppers, cockroaches, butterflies, etc. you can take. So when you come to mouth parts, apart from mandibles and maxillae, you have other structures called as labium and labrum. So in future classes, we'll be studying in detail about the mouth parts. So for today's class, you should know they have one pair of mandibles, one pair of maxillae and a structure called labium and labrum. And insects, they respire through trachea. So if you like, if you take the close-up of the respiratory system, so inside you'll find the tube-like structures. So these tube-like structures are called as trachea. And these trachea, they open to outside through a small opening, which is called as spiracle. So here, remember, insects, they respire through structures called as trachea. So when you come to the developmental stages, so they develop through larval stages. So insects, they develop through larval stages. So here in insects, you come across both terrestrial as well as aquatic insects. So these are the relatives of insects, like crabs, prawns, lobsters, like mites, spiders and ticks, like millipedes and centipedes. So these are the relatives of insects with their special characteristic features. So in summary, if you take the characteristic features of all classes, so first one is Arachnida, Crustacea, Chylopoda, Diplopoda, Insects. So here in the first column, you can see the examples. In the second one, you can see in Arachnida and Crustacea, the body divisions are cephalothorax and abdomen. In Chylopoda and Diplopoda, body is divided into head and trunk. Whereas insects, the body is divided into head, thorax and abdomen. So when you come to antenna are absent in arachnids, two pairs of antenna in crustaceans, whereas in others you will find one pair of antenna. So in arachnids you have simple eyes, in crustaceans you have stalked compound eyes, in Chylopoda and Diplopoda you have simple eyes, in insects you have both simple and compound eyes. So when you come to legs, it is four pairs in arachnids, five or more pairs in crustaceans, one pair per segment in Chylopoda, two pair per segment in Diplopoda, three pairs in case of insects. So when you come to genital openings, so it is anterior in Arachnida, Crustacea and Diplopoda. Whereas in Chylopoda and insects, it is posterior in position. So when you come to mouth parts, Arachnida have chelicera and pedipalps, whereas in others, all others, you have mandibles and maxilla. So when you come to respiration, so arachnids may be through lungs or trachea, crustaceans by gills or body surface, whereas three, it is through trachea. So when you come to developmental stages, only in Chylopoda and Diplopoda, it is direct development, whereas in rest of the other stages, it is at the larval stages. So when you come to the principal habitat, so here in Arachnida and Crustacea, we have both terrestrial and aquatic. Whereas in Chylopoda and Diplopoda, both of them are terrestrial. Whereas in insects, it is both terrestrial as well as aquatic. So this is a summary table for the different characteristics of the close relatives of insects like arachnids, crustaceans, chylopods and diplopods. So this is about the relatives of insects and their characteristic features. So this finishes this chapter. So the next important chapter is the major points related to dominance of insecta in animal kingdom. So why insects are most dominant in animal kingdom? So what are the reasons for this dominance? So that we'll be studying now. So the dominance of insects, it can be assessed or measured in several ways. So the dominance of insects, it can be assessed by several ways. So there are three important parameters which we can measure for the dominance. So the first important parameter is the number of species. So the first important parameter to study the dominance is number of species. The second one is the number of individuals. The third one is distribution. Of insects. So based on these three parameters, we can judge that the insects are the most dominant group of animals in animal kingdom. So first we'll take up the number of species. So if the total number of insect species described is compared with other organisms, so insects outnumber all other organisms. I think in the very first class, I have showed you a pie chart regarding the dominance of insects. So do you remember how many species are there in insects reported so far? Anybody? How many species of insects?
सर
ओके
1.7 मिलियन सर।
10,50,000 स्पीशीज आर रिपोर्टेड सो फार फ्रॉम दि आइडेंटिफाइड स्पीशीज. सो इफ यू सीन द डायग्राम, इफ यू सीन द डायग्राम, सो 10,50,000 स्पीशीज हैव बीन सो फार रिपोर्टेड. सो इफ यू टेक प्लांट्स इट इज ओनली 4 to 5 lakhs. If you take animals other than insects, it is 8 lakhs. Vertebrates, 2 lakhs. I mean, lower invertebrates, it is 50,000. So, if you compare with all these three, all four types of organisms, so insects outnumber with respect to species. So, by this, we will come to know with respect to number of species, the insects dominate over the other kingdoms. So in kingdom Animalia, the insects outnumber the other group of organisms. So the first parameter used is the number of species. So as you see in the table, the insects outnumber the other group of organism. The second one is the number of individuals. The second parameter to measure the dominance of insects is the number of individuals. So already I told you that there are around 10,50,000 species reported today. So still one third to one half of the earth's insects have not yet been described. That means only 1 million species or 1.05 million species are identified so far. Still around 8 million species of insects are yet to be described. That means only 1 million species are described so far. Still 1/7, that is another 8 million species are yet to be described on the earth today. So all of you know that there are many insects which live inside the soil. So the insects that live in the soil are not completely explored and identified. So there are many insects living inside the soil. So far, hardly 1% or 2% of soil insects might have been identified. Still 90 to 98%, they are still unexplored. And there are some insects which live deep in the forest. For example, if you take Amazon forest, so no person is ready to go into the deep forest and collect the insects and identify. So there are many such forests in the world where some of the insects that might be present which are not yet collected and identified. So in this way we can tell that insects will outnumber the other organisms. So if you take the density of an insect species, it is very high compared to the density of animals. For example, if you take a country like India, so how many people are present on an average in a square kilometer? So roughly what may be the number of people which may be present in the 1 square kilometer area based on the population or based on the census? So what is the population of India?
131 crore,
I think 136 now, 136 crores. So if you take Karnataka, it may be around 6 or 7 crores. So if you take that 6 or 7 crores, so what may be the approximate number of people living in a square meter area? Maybe 500,000? So it will be around less, maybe 500 or 1000 or 1500 people per square meter area. So what may be the number of insects living in a square meter area? So if you look here, so can you tell what these insects are? Anybody, can you tell what these insects are? So this is a building. This is a building. Huh? Locust. So do you know anything about locust? So I think people, you might have read in the news, maybe 6 months or 10 months back, there was a locust outbreak in Rajasthan, Jammu Kashmir, Maharashtra and all. Are you aware of this?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Okay, what are locusts means? Locusts are shorthorn grasshoppers. Locusts are shorthorn grasshoppers. Whenever the conditions are favorable, they multiply themselves and they start migrating. So why should they migrate? So because due to the lack of food and shelter, so they keep on moving from one place to another. I think in previous class I might have told you the locust will migrate one country to another country, traveling thousands of kilometers. So this is a recent outbreak of locust in Rajasthan, where they started migrating to other parts of India. So you'll find millions of insects in a square meter area. And I think all of you are aware of ants. All of you are aware of ants. You can see here the population of ants may be in a square feet. So square feet means 30 centimeter by 30 centimeter. So in 30 centimeter by 30 centimeter, you can find thousands of ants. So if you compare the density or number of individuals, so the population of insects per square meter or square feet is very high. So I'll give a few examples with respect to number of individuals. So I think most of you might have observed ant nest. I think most of you might have observed this ant nest. From outside, it looks like a small, simple hole. From outside, it looks like a small, simple hole. Once you go inside this hole, you can find thousands or millions or lakhs of ants. For example, a colony of ant may contain up to 20 million individuals. A colony of ants may contain 20 million individuals. For example, I think what is the population of our world? Anybody? What is the population of our world?
750.
So the rough estimate is around 7.9 billion. The population of the world, human beings in the world, is 7.9 billion. So all of you know, 1000 millions is equal to 1 billion. So remember, if one nest contains 20 million individuals, maybe if you put 100 nests, it will be equal to the population of the world. Or if you put 100 nests together, the 100 nests of ants, it will almost be equal to the population of human beings in this world. So here, what I wanted to say is, the number of individuals will outnumber the number of human beings present in the world. And here you can see, last class also had houses or buildings built by termites. In this diagram, if you see, this is the queen termite, this is the king termite, and this is the worker termite. So usually, if you take a single colony of termites, you will find several thousand to several million insects inside this termite mound. Usually, termites are very hard-working insects. They never sleep. So termites, they never sleep. So they build their colonies 24 hours a day. That means they don't waste time like human beings. They utilize their time very efficiently. So in case of human beings, people who don't work, what in Kannada we call somberis. So in insects, we don't find such insects. For example, the largest termite colony, contained around 3 million insects. So what is the population of the world? I told you, 7.9 billion. So you can imagine, if you put a few hundred or few thousand termite mounds, that will be equivalent to the population of human beings. So if you take this queen, the egg-laying capacity of the queen is around 15 to 25 eggs per minute. So queen can lay around 15 to 25 eggs per minute. If the insects multiply at this rate, so what will be the population of termites? So one estimate says it will be around 40,000 termite eggs per day. So a queen termite can lay 40,000 eggs per day. So this you can imagine that the tremendous capacity or tremendous reproductive capacity has been observed in insects. And this is a picture of a swarm of migratory locust. So in a swarm, you can find up to 10 billion individuals. In a single migratory locust swarm, you can find 10 billion individuals. So the population of human beings is 7.9. The population of human beings is 7.9. Here it is 10 billion of individuals in an individual swarm. You can see here a person is walking, and you can see the population of locust around him. And when they are migrating from one place to another, they eat thousands of tons of fresh vegetation. So when they are moving from one place to another place, so after every 4 or 5 hours, they settle in a place. Once they settle, they eat up everything. That means they don't leave even a single leaf. Then in that way, they are voracious feeders. So this is a recent outbreak of locust in Jaipur in May 27th, 2020. So you can see here, this is a mango tree. So the mango is bearing fruits. So the farmer is trying to save his crop by frightening the termites. So you can see the population of termites in the mango tree. You can see the population of grasshoppers resting on the wall. Here, you can see the grasshoppers that are resting on a tree. So once they rest on the tree, maybe today you might have seen foliage. Maybe tomorrow the entire foliage will be not there. So in this way, they are voracious feeders when they move from one place to another place. So now you can understood that the insects are the most dominating creatures, both in number, distribution, and number of individuals. So coming to the third point, the distribution of insects. So can anyone tell where you can't find insects? Is there any place free of insects?
Antarctica.
Is there any place free of insects? Can you name a place which is free of insects?
Antarctica.
Antarctica. What about Arctic? In Arctic and Antarctic also you find insects, but the population is very less. So what I mean to say is, insects are present everywhere, but in colder climate situation like Arctic or Antarctic, you do find insects, but the population is very lower. So insects are abundant in almost all types of ecological habitats. So insects are present in almost all types of ecological habitats. So they live everywhere. The only place on the earth where insects are less in numbers is in ocean depth. So inside the ocean also you will find insects, but the number is less. But flies and beetles, they are also found in the deep of the ocean. For example, insects are found in a variety of habitats, but usually the number is more where the climate is warmer. So if the climate is warmer, you will find a more number of insects. So insects can be found almost everywhere on the planet Earth, even in Arctic and Antarctic. For example, insects living on the land surface are called as terrestrial insects. Insects living on the land surface are called as terrestrial insects. So you can find insects in the forest, you can find insects in the caves, you can find the insects in grasslands, you can find them in deserts, you can find them in garden. So all these are terrestrial insects. So you can also find aquatic insects, the insects that live inside the water. So you may find insects in the fresh water, you may find insects in the streams, you may find insects in the ponds, rivers, oceans. That is, in all the aquatic bodies you come across insects. And also deep inside the soil you can find insects. That means insects are present everywhere, terrestrial, aquatic, deep inside the soil you can find insects. So the population is more if the climate is warm, but in colder climates you do find insects, the population is very low. So these are the three parameters which measure the dominance. First, the number of individuals, the number of species, and thirdly, the distribution. So these are the some of the factors that are considered to be to tell that insects are most dominant creatures on the earth surface. So the next question is, what are the factors that are responsible for insect dominance? So can anybody tell few points which may lead to the dominance of insects?
So they are exoskeleton, so it is very hard. They can survive anywhere because of it.
Okay, let me come to the point. There are several factors that are responsible for insect dominance. Take up one by one. So there is no single morphological or single physiological character that can account for the dominance of insects. So you cannot tell it is a single morphological character or single physiological characters that can account for their success. So insects have a unique combination or a number of characters which as a whole have given them an unusual survival advantage, and hence they are dominant on the earth surface. So there are various characteristic features which contribute to insect dominance. So we can classify the factors responsible insect dominance into three major characters. So I can classify the characteristic features into three major factors. The first one are structural characters. Second one are developmental characters. And the third one are protective adaptations. So these are the three major factors that are responsible for the insect dominance. So first we will take up the structural characters. So what are the structural characters that are responsible for insect dominance? So as one of the students told, the first and foremost important character is exoskeleton. So remember, insects are the only organisms where the skeleton is located on the outer side of the body, whereas vertebrates, they possess a skeleton on the inner side of the body. So outer means don't imagine that it is on the outer side of the body. It is present on the outer border but inside the body. So exoskeleton means it is present in the borders, that is below the skin. Whereas in case of vertebrates, the skeleton is present inside the body. And this exoskeleton is made up of a cuticular protein which is called as chitin. So exoskeleton is made up of a cuticular substance called as chitin. And insect exoskeleton is light in weight. So compared to human skeletons, so insect exoskeleton is light in weight. And this skeleton gives strength, rigidity and flexibility to the insect body. So the chitinous exoskeleton gives strength, rigidity and flexibility to the insect body. So there are some functions of insect exoskeleton. So in exoskeleton, the first one is they prevent desiccation or water loss from the insect body. So in which type of insects this will be a problem? So where is the water loss problem in which type of insects? Anybody?
Terrestrial
in which type of insects?
Like earthworms. So
I think most of you might have seen deserts, right? So in deserts, moisture is a major problem. So in insects that live in deserts, they have to conserve the water. So here, in such insects, the exoskeleton is modified in such a way that there is a minimal water loss from the insect body. So if the water loss has to be minimum, what should be the characteristic feature of the exoskeleton? So what should be the characteristic feature of exoskeleton if there should be minimal water loss? Have you heard of wax? So in some of the insects, there is a wax-like coating on the external body surface. So this wax-like coating, it helps in the minimization of the water loss. And second function is they prevent physical or mechanical injuries to the body. For example, by accident, if the insects fall from a height to a lower elevation, they may get damaged. So this exoskeleton, it prevents the physical or mechanical injuries to the body. Third one, the exoskeleton provides shape and size to the insect body. So they help in maintaining the shape and size of the insect body. And also this exoskeleton, it provides area for muscle attachment. So it provides area for the muscle attachments. And also it gives strength to the body appendages. So the body appendages, they may be legs, they may be wings, they may be mouth parts, they may be antenna. So this gives strength to the appendages. So the first and foremost reason for insect dominance is insect exoskeleton, which is located on the outer side of the body, which gives strength, rigidity, flexibility, and it helps in these functions. So the first character is exoskeleton. The second one is the size. The size, I think in previous class I showed you the smallest insect. So do you remember what is the smallest size of insects? What was the smallest size of insects?
0.13 millimeter.
0.17 or 0.13, if I remember correctly, right? So what is the advantage of insects being very small? What is the advantage of insects being very small?
Surface area is reduced, sir.
See, if the insect is small in size, they require less space for their existence, right? They require less space for their existence. Similarly, the requirement of food is also very less. And also the energy requirement of the body is less. And if they are smaller in size, the natural enemies, they cannot locate them. That means they can easily escape from the natural enemies. So small size is advantageous to the insect because they require less space, their food requirement is less, energy requirement is less, and they can easily escape from the enemies. So they can crawl into hidden places. So in previous class I was telling you about the hair lice or hair louse. So where the insects hide in between the hair. So there are no other organisms which can enter into our hair except the body lice. So the second important character is the size of the insects. Because of their small size, they can exploit different ecological niches where other animals cannot access. The third one is compound eyes. The third one is compound eyes. So in previous class I was telling you insects have compound eyes. Insects have compound eyes. So if you look here, this is the compound eye of a dragonfly. So if you take a close-up under microscope, so these compound eyes are made up of individual units which are hexagonal in shape. So these compound eyes, they are made up of individual units which are hexagonal in shape, and these are called as ommatidia. So these are called as ommatidia. So these ommatidia are hexagonal in shape. So remember, in each compound eye you may find thousands of ommatidia. That means if the image has to form, if the image has to form in the insect eye, all the light should pass through all the ommatidia. So the light passing through all the ommatidia leads to the formation of a compound image. So remember, even if one ommatidia gets damaged, still the insect can have a complete, almost a complete image of the structure. So the third important characteristic feature that led to the dominance of insects is the presence of compound eyes. Next is scattered sense organs. For example, so which are the sense organs in case of human beings? External sense organs. What are the sense organs?
Eyes, nose.
Eyes, nose.
Skin.
Okay, we have eyes. Ear. We have eyes. We have nose. We have ear. We have tongue. We have skin, etc. What about the location of these organs in case of human beings? Except skin, where are these sensory organs present in the human beings? Which part of the body?
The head part of body.
That means majority of the sense organs in case of human beings, they are present in the head region, right? Except skin. So in case of human beings, majority of the sense organs, they are located in the head region except for the skin. But when you come to insects, the sense organs include visual organs, that is eyes, gustatory organs, that is taste, organs of touch, that is tactile organs, which are present on the different parts of the insect body. For example, antenna that helps in sensing, eyes that helps in seeing, mouth parts that helps in tasting, they are present in the head region. And the legs with claws, that is tactile organs, they are present in the thorax. So do you remember last time I told one fact about flies, where the tasting organs are present in the legs? Do you remember?
Yes, sir.
That means in case of insects, the tasting organs, they are present in the legs of the thoracic region. Similarly, the hearing organ. The hearing organ is called as tympanum. So the hearing organ is located in the abdominal region. So what I wanted to say is, in case of human beings, majority of the sense organs, they are located in the head region. But in case of insects, they are scattered throughout the body. So some of them are situated in the head region, some of them are situated in the thoracic region, some of them are situated in the abdominal region. So this scatteredness of all the body prevents the chances of all of them being damaged at a time. That means if the head is damaged, only few sense organs are damaged. The others are still functional. So in this way, since the sense organs are scattered throughout the body, this is also one of the reasons for the dominance of insects in the world. The next one is decentralized nervous system. Decentralized nervous system. So morning I was talking about the decentralized nervous system. So here, what about human beings? Where is the nervous system located in human beings?
Sir, in head region and
spinal cord.
That means in the head region we have brain, whereas the rest of the thing is located in the spinal cord behind the body, right? Similarly, in insects also, we have a decentralized nervous system, where the brain is located in the head region, whereas ventral nerve cord and ganglia that are present in the thorax and abdominal region. I think in last class, when I was mentioning one of the fact, I told you that the cockroach can survive without the head for 9 days. Do you remember?
Yes, sir.
That means when the head is cut, only brain is damaged, but still other nervous system is present in the thorax and the abdomen. So these ganglia, they can coordinate the legs, wings and other parts of the body. That means still you can see the legs moving, because whatever the thoracic ganglia that are present in the thorax, still they have control over the legs. Similarly, whatever the nervous system that is present in the abdomen, it can control the other activities in the abdomen. So what I wanted to say is, brain is situated in the head region, whereas the rest of the ganglia, they are located in the thorax and abdomen. So because of this purpose, even if some part of the body is damaged, still the insect can coordinate with the other part of the nervous system. So this is the fifth reason for the domination of insect. The next one is body segmentation. and jointed appendages. So I told you when I was telling arthropoda, arthro means joint, poda means legs. So this segmentation allows specialization of body regions for different functions. For example, the head region is a sensory part and it helps, it also helps in feeding. So all of you know that the antenna helps in sensing the things and the mouth parts help in feeding. So the head is specialized for sensing and feeding. The thorax is specialized for locomotion, that is movement. Since they have three pairs of legs and two pairs of wings, so legs help in walking or running, wings help in flying. And the abdomen, it helps in various functions like digestion, reproduction and excretion. So this facilitates freedom of movement and improves the efficiency. Since each part has a specific function, so the body segmentation and jointed appendages has an advantage and one of the factor responsible for insect dominance. And next is the locomotion. So we have what is called as hexapod locomotion. Already I told you, insects have six legs. Hexa means six, poda means leg. Remember, insects always walk on tripod movement. So what about human beings? How will we walk? All of you know that we have two pairs of legs, right?
Yes, sir.
So how will we walk? Simple question. Every day you keep
sir,
on walking. See, when one foot is on the ground, the other foot is lifted, right? If the left leg is on the ground surface, you lift the right leg. Then you keep the right leg down, lift the left leg. This is the way you keep walking. Am I correct?
Yes, sir.
What will happen if you lift two legs together?
Monopod movement.
What will happen to you? You will fall down, right?
Yes, sir.
Since there is no balance, since there is no stability, you will fall down. So in case of human beings, when one foot is on the ground, the other foot is lifted. So can you tell how will be the walking movement in case of insects if it has seven, six legs? So how many legs are lifted? How many will be on ground?
Two legs are lifted.
Huh? Two legs are lifted, four will be on the ground?
Three, sir.
Three lifted and three ground.
So in the right side diagram, can you make out an ant with colored legs, blue colored legs, red colored legs?
Alternate legs are being moved up and down.
Now can you make out a diagram with blue colored legs and red colored legs?
Yes, sir.
That means the blue color is left side first leg, right? This is left side third leg. Am I correct? This is right side first leg, right side third leg. That is left first, left second, left third. Right first, right second, right third. That means what I wanted to say is this blue resembles a tripod. Tripod means three points. That means when the insect legs are, for example, if you take blue legs, if these blue legs are resting on the ground surface, these three legs are lifted. That means two sides of one leg of another side, opposite side. That means two legs of left side, one middle leg of right side, they are lifted, whereas the other left side one leg, right side two legs are moved. You got my point? What I want to say is, insects always walk on three legs. Remember, insects always walk on three legs, which is called as tripod. So if you look here, when the blue colored legs are on the ground surface, the red colored legs are lifted. When the red colored legs are on the ground surface, blue colored legs are lifted. So in this way, the insects always walk on tripod stand, that is three legs up, three legs down. So my next question is, with respect to balance and stability, whether human legs are most balanced and stabilized or insect legs are most stabilized and balanced?
Insects.
Suppose if a human being loses his one leg, what will be his stability? Suppose if you accidentally lose one of your leg, is your body balanced?
No, sir.
No. That means human body is less stabilized and less balanced because of two pairs of legs. Whereas insects, they are more stabilized and they are more balanced. That means even if it loses one leg, the body can be balanced and stabilized. Will you accept my statement?
Yes.
So in this way, even if the insect loses one of the legs, still the insect can easily. I think still there are many reasons for insect dominance. I think I'll stop here, as there is some time required for other teacher also to be log in and continued for the class. So what we'll do is, Saturday as usual, we'll continue our lecture class in the third hour. So if you have any doubts, you can interact with me. With respect to insect dominance or the characteristic features of phylum Arthropoda. I want you people to interact. If it was a physical class, we were meeting face to face and I would have directly interacted with you. Since this is offline class, so you also find difficulty and even me also find difficulty. So in spite of that, you can unmute and you can ask questions, so that it will be more lively rather than one-way discussion. Okay, let me have one question. So how long will the human beings grow? Till what age the humans keep on growing?
18 years.
So you mean to, after 18 years, 18 to 20, after 20 years the growth completely ceases, right?
Yes, sir.
So are you talking,
are you talking about vertical growth or horizontal growth?
Both, sir. Vertical growth, sir. Horizontal growth may be deposition of fats.
So vertical growth, as you told, vertical growth ceases in by 18 or 20 years, but horizontal growth can be continued. Right?
Yes, sir.
What about insects? How will growth take place in insects? Is it similar to human beings or different?
Different, sir.
So how insects differ from human beings with respect to growth? Anybody? So somebody answered that it is different. So how they are different from human beings with respect to growth? Have you heard of the term metamorphosis?
Yes, sir.
So what do you mean by metamorphosis?
Changing of shape.
Change in shape and form of an insect, right?
Yes, sir.
So in metamorphosis, you may find two stages or three stages. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
So you may find egg, larva, pupa, adult. Right?
Yes, sir.
So in which stage the growth takes place then? Will growth take place in all the four stages or restricted to one stage?
Sir, when it is adult, there is only...
My question is, you told there are four stages in insects: egg stage, larval stage, pupal stage, adult stage. So I wanted to know whether growth takes place in all the four stages or if the growth is restricted to any one of the stage.
Growth restricted in adult stage.
Okay, this is the assignment. So think over, and you come with the answer tomorrow. Tomorrow in the sense Saturday. So since the other teacher will start the class, I'll stop here. So we'll meet. So I think the chat box, some questions are there. Okay, all four stages, it's a wrong answer. So all four stages is a wrong answer. You come up with correct answer next class.
Sir, so I think, it's restricted in fourth stage, sir, adult stage.
No, you are wrong. So come up with correct answer in next class. So okay, I think I'll stop here. I think I'll stop here. Your next teacher will be waiting. I'll log out. Okay, thank you, everybody.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Record.